It took us 3 weeks. We did a doctrine on God for 7 weeks. We then did a doctrine of Jesus for about five. And then we did a whole doctrine of the Holy Spirit for about four. And we're able to kind of look at the Trinity individually. But today I have to give you a kind of whole picture. But we're going to be in Ephesians 3, 14 through 17a. We'll get there in a little bit. But I've got to set this up. This is kind of be more like a teaching lesson because there's so much here. But today what we'll be looking at, the first blank, is one of the hardest things to understand and believe in all of Christianity, and that is the Trinity. Why is the Trinity so hard? Well, honestly, if you have to ask that question, then you may have never had to try to explain the Trinity to someone else. The Trinity is not easy to explain. It's very difficult to explain. And then for a lot of people, it's seen as a sort of paradox. And also, the word Trinity itself is not mentioned in the Bible, which can be a stumbling block for a lot of people. So we're going to go deep. As I try to tell people when I go over something deep, don't let it scare you, but I have confidence and I believe in you. And don't intimidate yourself. It's not too deep and it's not too complicated. And I try to tell the students whenever we do something deep, don't treat it like homework where if you don't get it, you yell and you scream and you give up. This is something that you will be able to get. I would actually say there are some pastors out there, there are some churches out here who would think that I'm crazy and that Brad's crazy for me and to go over the Trinity because it's so difficult. But the thing is I think that's something we should look at. But to understand the Trinity, you have three distinct persons of the Trinity. You have God the Father, you have God the Son, and you have God the Holy Spirit. So the best way that I can explain to try to understand the Trinity is if you wanted to meet a great famous person. So I want you to get an idea of maybe it's a band, maybe it's an artist, maybe it's someone you really admire, an actor, that you would really want to meet. That one person where you're like, that is one person. If I would have made it if I had met that one person. So I want you to think of that. So there's a lot of people we'd want to meet. Maybe an athlete. You dream about it. But a lot of times if we were actually to meet that person, we would get nervous. We might freeze and say nothing. As some girls do when they meet their favorite band, they freak out and scream, and they run away. I had a mentor of mine, he took some of his girls, his students, to a concert, and they happened to so meet their favorite frontman, and when they saw him, they literally screamed and ran off. They said nothing to him. They had the opportunity to meet him and talk to him. Well, I had a similar opportunity. If you go to the next slide, Bobby. When I was young, there was this band during the boy band era that I enjoyed. This was a Christian band. Their name was Plus One during the time of Zoe Girl and when Natalie Grant was just starting. She was actually an opener for this band. This was in the 90s. And we had gone early to meet them. They were at a place away from the concert, signing posters and memorabilia. And we got the opportunity because they invited us to go backstage and meet them at the concert. Well, I was like, wow, this is pretty awesome. Natalie Grant wasn't big at that time, so I had no idea who she was, and I knew who Zoe Girl was, but I was like, Plus One. This is my favorite group that I listen to. Well, when my brother and I got backstage, we asked really dumb, stupid questions, such as, why did you do your hair that way? Or why do you dress that way? And so we were nervous, and then after that, I remember we walked out, my dad kind of looked at us, and we were embarrassed by the questions we had asked. We had froze. We got nervous. And when we meet famous persons or people, it can feel like we've met God. And that's how we treat those people sometimes. And oftentimes, we blow our opportunity to really get to know what those people are like. And sometimes we may even do that with God himself. So don't let today freak you out. Again, the Trinity is three distinct persons, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, and God the Son. And the greatest thing is, though, is that next, God wants you to know him. God isn't maybe like another famous person who doesn't want all the attention or doesn't want people going crazy and wanting to know them. God desires for us to know him. He gave us his word so that we can know him. And so, even another illustration is it's kind of like dating. I get really curious to ask people, especially students, why they date somebody else. Like, I ask questions of What do you currently see in that person, or did you see in them before you started dating? And it's funny because sometimes they can't give an answer. The reason that is because there wasn't really a conversation to begin with before they started to date. They didn't really get to know one another. And let me give you some advice. Get to know a person on all the different levels of their life before you even start dating them. And why do I say that? Because it can keep you from hurt, it can keep you from emotions, it can keep you from pain, it can keep you from drama and a lot of Kleenexes along the way. But why do I say that? It's because, why do you need to get somebody to know on all different levels? It's because you need to know what type of son or daughter they are. You need to know what type of brother or sister they are. You need to know what kind of student they are in school. You need to know what kind of church member they are. You need to know how they treat others. What they are like at home away from others. Are they mean or are they lazy? If they're an athlete, do they play for their self or do they play for the team? That's the same thing we need to do with God. We need to get to know him on all different levels. We don't need to stay for an over-the-top view. We need to get deep and understand who he truly is. Because otherwise we're wasting our time. And why do we need to look at him in a deeper way? So we can truly appreciate him. And so we can love him more and really experience him. So why should we understand the Trinity? It's so that we can know God more. It's so that we can know the Bible better. And so we know how to pray to experience God deeper and ultimately live out salvation. So what we did during our Doctrine of God series, we looked at false beliefs. Every week we looked at false beliefs and heresies. So the first one on there is Hinduism. I kind of talked about this last week. They believe that there are so many gods that you can't count them all. That would be polytheism. That's what they believe in. And many people who would believe in Hinduism treat the Trinity as three different gods. So if you came up to them and said, okay, you know, I believe in God the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, the Light, and you say the Trinity, well, they would say, no, you believe in three different gods. Well, then you're kind of stuck trying to explain how God is triune, which can be very difficult. Well, then the next one is Islam. Islam believes that Allah is the only God and he has no son, which the only issue with that is means that we have no Jesus. Jesus is vitally important for us. If there's no Jesus, we have no salvation. Next is modalism. This is a deep theological term. It says that the God of the Bible is only one person, but he shows himself as Father, Son, and Spirit at different times. Well, that's not true about the Trinity. That's not true about God. He is Trinity from eternity past to eternity future. The last one is adoptionism. Adoptionism, they say that Jesus isn't eternally fully God, but God chose to adopt him at his son at his baptism. There's actually a big church in Houston. The wife of the pastor got up one Sunday and actually said that she believes that Jesus was human until God touched him at his baptism. There are many people who believe this. I taught this past week at West Lawrence High School, and I had a good question about this because the teacher was asking me, how could someone believe adoptionism where other places in the Bible it has nothing to do with that? Well, it's a lot of what Brad teaches us on Sunday nights is where you have to look at correlation. You could take this and believe it, but where else does it say in the Bible this? Or does it match up? It doesn't. And there are people who believe in adoptionism. But there's also different analogies that are wrong and actually condemned as heresies. The first one is that many of us would recognize is the egg. The egg consists of a shell. It consists of an egg white. It consists of a yolk. But the problem is that the Trinity is three persons, not three parts. Each part of the Trinity is fully God. If I were to give you one piece of the egg, you wouldn't say that it's an egg unless all parts were together. So if I gave you an egg yolk, you would say that's an egg yolk, not an egg. When you look at one person of the Trinity, you see God. I actually was teaching a lesson here, and I had a book, and I had just started studying the Trinity, and they actually gave me an analogy or a story to use, and it consisted of the egg, which I think it's a good idea to get a good picture, but the problem is if you believe and then you start explaining someone about the egg and you don't really know how to explain it well as in truth, you've then actually in a way committed teaching a false belief about the Trinity. But the one that's probably most notable to us is the three-leaf clover. I was taught this growing up. The only problem with this is it views God as one-third and one-third and one-third. it would say that each part of the Trinity is a third of God. That's not true. Again, if you were to look at God, if you were able to look at the Trinity, if you looked at the Holy Spirit, you would see God. If you look at the Son, Jesus, you would see God. If you look at God, you would see Jesus. They don't make up, not Jesus, you look at the God the Father, you see God. And then last, again, another one we're all familiar with is water, the different states of water, liquid, ice, and vapor. This is a form of modalism, like I just said earlier. God does not exist at different times as the Trinity. He is always the Trinity and has always been the Trinity. So I can explain all this to you, but I have a short video with some guys that will explain this a little bit better. Go ahead, Bobby.
Okay, Patrick, tell us a bit more about this Trinity thing.
Yeah, Patrick, tell us.
But remember that we're simple people without your fancy education and books and learning, and we're hearing about all of this for the first time. So try to keep it simple, okay, Patrick?
Yeah, real simple, Patrick.
Sure, there are three persons of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, yet there is only one God.
Don't get what you're saying here, Patrick.
Not picking up what you're laying down here, Patrick.
Could you use an analogy, Patrick?
Sure. The Trinity is like water and how you can find water in three different forms. Liquid and ice and vapor.
That's modalism, Patrick!
What?
Modalism, an ancient heresy confessed by teachers such as Noetus and Sibelius, which espouses that God is not three distinct persons, but that he merely reveals himself in three different forms. This heresy was clearly condemned in Canon 1 at the First Council of Constantinople in 381 AD, and those who confess it cannot rightly be considered a part of the Church Catholic. Come on, Patrick!
Yeah, get it together, Patrick!
Okay, then the Trinity is like the sun in the sky, where you have the star, and the light, and the heat.
Oh, Patrick. Come on, Patrick.
That's Arianism, Patrick.
Arianism?
Yes, Arianism, Patrick. A theology which states that Christ and the Holy Spirit are creations of the Father and not one in nature with him. Exactly like how heat and light are not the star itself, but are merely creations of the star. That's a bad analogy, Patrick.
You're the worst, Patrick.
All right, sorry. The Trinity is like this three-leaf clover here.
I'm gonna stop you right there, Patrick.
Yeah, hold your horses, Patrick.
You're about to confess partialism.
Partialism?
Yes, partialism, a heresy which asserts that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are not distinct persons of the Godhead, but are different parts of God, each composing one-third of the divine.
And who confesses the heresy of partialism?
The first season of the cartoon program Voltron, where five robot lion cars merge together to form one giant robot samurai, obviously.
I've never heard of Voltron.
Of course you haven't. It's not going to exist for another 1,500 years now, Patrick.
Yeah, get with the program, Patrick.
I mean, really, Patrick.
I'm going to stab you in the face, Patrick.
Okay, that was probably a bit much.
All right, I'll try again. The Trinity is like how the same man can be a husband and a father and an employer.
Modalism again.
All right, then it's like the three layers of an apple.
Partialism revisited.
Fine, the Trinity is a mystery which cannot be comprehended by human reason, but is understood only through faith and is best confessed in the words of the Athanasian Creed, which states that we worship one God in Trinity and Trinity in unity, neither confusing the persons nor dividing the substance, that we are compelled by the Christian truth to confess that each distinct person is God and Lord, and that the deity of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is one, equal in glory, co-equal in majesty.
Well, why didn't you just say that, Patrick?
Yeah, quit beating around the bush, Patrick.
Okay. So, I don't know if you got all that. But there's no good analogies. And if you caught what he said at the end, he's talking about the Athanasian Creed. The Trinity is a mystery. It cannot be understood through human reason, and it can only be understood through faith. You think you have a good analogy, you can bring it to me later, but a mentor of mine, he taught his students the Trinity, and he's told them all about the bad analogies, and then he had one student that came up and ran up to him after, and he said, "Chip, I've got it." And my mentor, Chip, said, "No, you don't. There are no good analogies." He's like, "No, I really have it." So he's like, "Fine, tell me what it is." And the kid, no lie, looks at him and says, "A three-headed dog." Well, there's still issues there, but that's the closest one that my mentor has heard of, but it's still wrong. Well, for a lot of us, we've seen a symbol. The next slide, called the Trinitarian. Many of us may have seen this, that we view the Trinity in this way, or it's explained this way. I think it's good. I don't think it's the best way. If you look on the back of your notes and then the next one, I think this is the one that best explains the Trinity, which shows us that God is in the middle. God is the Son. God is the Father. God is the Holy Spirit. But if you notice around the sides, it says the Father is not the Son. The Son is not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not the Father, and vice versa. They are not each other. They are three distinct persons, but they are all God. Now, why are there no good analogies? And how do we understand that God exists in three different persons? Well, we need to understand that God exists in Trinity all the way from eternity past to eternity future. God ceases to no longer be the Trinity. He is no longer God. So why are there no good analogies? Because we're talking about the Trinity. We're talking about God. God is transcendent. God is completely beyond us. We have no understanding or no idea of what it means to be God. But if we were fully to explain and know God, He would no longer be God. We would no longer need Him, because then we would know what it is to be God. God is infinite. God is glorious, God is great, and He is matchless. We can't explain it. The thing is, we have to accept it and we have to believe it by faith. As I said, not everyone can go deep, and some people would think I'm nuts. But the thing is, we need to be tired of the same old stuff. We need to want to go deep. We need to show people what we can do, and we're not too young or too old to learn this. So Ephesians 3:14 through 17a says this: "For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. I pray that He may grant you, according to the riches of His glory, to be strengthened with power in the inner man through the Spirit, and that the Messiah may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and firmly established in love." In verse 14, we are told to pray to the Father. In the Trinity, the Father is the head, which tells us there is a hierarchy. The Father is the creator. He's the one that put everything into motion. And the other persons of the Trinity submit to the Father. We see that Jesus often said, he said that there's no greater thing for Him to do than to follow the will of the Father, because He submitted to the will of the Father. The Father is the planner. The Father is the person of the Trinity who gets the glory, the honor, and the praise, and all answer to Him. But in verse 17, we see the Son, who is Jesus. He's the one that dwells in our hearts through faith. He is the one of the Trinity who gets the glory in our lives, and He is the reason we live. Jesus is the second member of the Trinity. He brings glory and honor not to Himself, but to the Father. Jesus is the second member of the Trinity because He is our mediator. He is the one who is advocating for us before the Father. And we focus on Jesus to become more like Him, and we give Him our attention. But verse 16 gives us the Spirit. Verse 16, it's about the Holy Spirit. Many people don't understand the Holy Spirit. And I can't go into this. I can't go into all the stuff about the Holy Spirit. I had questions from our local high school students about it. I'd have to have 4 weeks to teach you about the Holy Spirit. But a lot of times we get the view of the Holy Spirit wrong. But the thing is, many people don't understand the Holy Spirit. But He's the one who resides and dwells in us. Our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the one who gives us power. He's the one who gives us strength. He's the one who gives us wisdom. He's the one who controls us and also helps us worship. We need to understand how these three persons in the Trinity relate together. Their relationships with each other. But they all have different roles, and they all are God. They are each fully God. They are not three parts of God. They don't exist at three different times as God, but they also work together. But how do we understand? Well, there's examples of the Trinity throughout the Bible. In John 4:34, we see how the Father has authority and how He's loving and leads His Son. And the Son loves to follow and submit and do the Father's will. In Acts 2:33, we see that Jesus is the one who actually sends the Spirit. In John 14:15-16, Jesus the Son is talking about the coming of the Spirit and how the Spirit will teach us. In Genesis, all the way going back to the beginning, in Genesis 1:1-3, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit are all present at creation. The Father creates. The Spirit is hovering over the process of creation. It says that the Spirit is hovering over the water. And the Son is the Word of God. In Genesis 1:26, man is created, and it said, God says, let us create man in our own image. Why would He say us? Because of the Trinity. In Matthew 3, when Jesus is baptized, where the people, again, some people take adoptionism out of it, God is the voice and says, this is my Son who I am well pleased. And then the Spirit comes down and rests on Jesus coming from the sky. In the Great Commission in Matthew 28, we are told to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, not names. Not three different parts, not three separate people. They all are three together, God. And finally, in Ephesians 1, we see that God is the one watching, creating, and sent His Son, Jesus. Jesus is living here on earth. He helps us understand what God is like. What would God do and what would God say? Because Jesus helps us connect us to God. He lived as the God-man through the power of the Holy Spirit, not acting on His power, but through the guiding of the Holy Spirit. And because of the Holy Spirit, Jesus had power and He lived a perfect life and He also had compassion. And we are able to receive that same Spirit. Jesus didn't live on His own. All of the Trinity are responsible for our salvation. All of the Trinity are responsible for salvation. So don't settle for thinking about God generically. Actually have a relationship with Him and know Him deeply. Get to know who God truly is. Yes, there's going to be times where you're not going to understand something. You may have someone and you're talking to them about God. You're talking to them about Christianity and they blow you away with a question you've never heard of. That's okay. You don't have to know everything, but you can look it up. You can come and talk to Brad. You can go and talk to someone who may be more spiritually along in their faith that can help guide you, and then you can go back. But we don't need to be scared off by God. We don't need to think that He doesn't want us to know Him. He desires for us to know Him. And ultimately, we see that through Him sending His Son, Jesus. He wants a relationship with us. So, God gets the glory. We follow Jesus, and the Spirit lives in us. This is one thing I've had to get corrected and help us understand. We don't ask Jesus into our heart. We ask Jesus to be the Lord of our life. The Spirit lives in us. Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father. The Spirit is the one who lives in us, that gives us power, that helps us understand what to do and guides us. But the thing is, we also have a relationship with all three. Not just one. Not just Jesus. So the question is, do you know Him? Do you actually know God? Have you given your life to Him? As I tell you, the Trinity changes everything about your life. It changes everything about how you live. The Trinity changes how we know God. Because it changes our relationship, because the more we understand the Trinity, the more we understand God, we see how they have relationship with each other, how they treat each other. We see how the relationship between God the Father, we see a relationship between God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit. It changes how we know the Bible and how we view the Bible. How we can see how people have believed wrong things about the Bible, heresies, wrong beliefs, and what is true about God and what is true about His Word. The Trinity changes how we know prayer and worship. Well, worship is studying the Bible, and it affects how we worship. And the Spirit is responsible for the one responsible for us to help us worship. This Trinity changes everything we know about community. We see through the Trinity that we are to enjoy friendships and conversation. We're not to isolate ourselves. The Trinity is not isolated. They work together continually. It's not about being by ourselves alone studying, but learning and growing together. The word koinonia. The God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are an example of that. The Trinity also changes how we know marriage. Jesus loves the church, His bride. The husband is supposed to be the same way. The more we understand Jesus, the more we understand the Trinity, it changes how we treat each other in marriage. It changes how we love each other. Because the more we understand Jesus, the more you understand the Trinity, we understand how we're supposed to live. The Trinity changes how we even know parenting, how we can be good parents and how to treat our children, but also for our children, how to understand how they need to submit to their parents. You've got God the Father, and He's got God the Son, but we see throughout the Bible and through Jesus' life that God the Son, Jesus, submitted to His Father's will and followed Him. But also, we sing the song, but we also know it through the Bible that God is a good, good Father who loves us and guides us and wants the best for us and let nothing stand in the way of having the best for us. But finally, the Trinity changes everything because it changes how we know unity and diversity. The body of Christ is made up of different people with different abilities, and God is glorified. The Trinity is made up of three distinct different persons, but they're one. The Trinity, the triuneness of God, was created by the church fathers to explain what we see in Scripture. Again, it's not in the Bible. We had to come up with a word to explain three persons who are one God. Without the church fathers, we would be up a creek without a paddle because we wouldn't know how to explain the Trinity at all. Because we would just see God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, not really understand or really know unless we got deep in it for ourselves. So we have a lot to thank the church fathers for helping us understand that. But the thing is, with the unity and diversity and how we see the Trinity working together, we see that we have one goal, that we are supposed to be one team working together and have one direction together. So God is always here. God is present. He hasn't left. And the Trinity is always here. Again, I said it earlier, the Trinity has existed from eternity past and will exist to eternity future. I don't know what that means when we have glorified bodies, when we go to heaven, and how we see God and how we view God. I don't know what that's going to look like, but it will all make sense to us then. Here on earth, we're never going to understand how God can be Trinity. We can't. Because our minds can't wrap our minds around it. But I think it has a lot to do with what Brad talked about, was it two Sunday nights ago, and talked about how sometimes we need to, in our Western mindset, we just look at it in one way with one hand and bullet points. Well, to explain the Trinity, we're never going to be able to understand it simply through bullet points. But in the Eastern mindset, they take it with two hands and are able to juggle it and understand that God is triune. God is three persons in one. That's how they view it, and that's how we need to see God and who He is through Scripture and how He states it. And trust it and have faith and believe in who He is.